Hello, welcome to my talk, all about the fluids. This talk is on the linear wave theory. Linear wave is also called as eddy wave, and the linear wave theory is a well-established theory, firstly published by George Eddy in 1841. The most important aspect in the linear wave theory is the establishment of the wave velocity potential function. Since it is the velocity potential function which is widely applied in the wave structure interaction, as well as to provide the basis for the higher order waves such as the Stokes wave. In the widely used boundary element method, BEM, for wave structure interaction, the wave velocity potential function is a must for describing the fluid motion, a foundation for wave structure interaction problem. Thus, it is important to introduce how the wave velocity potential function is obtained in this talk. The ocean waves cover a large range of different waves, with the period from less than 0.1 second to more than 24 hours. The shortest waves are those capillary and Laplace wave, for which we can see in the small ponds when the winds blow over it. The second wave are those period of seconds to tenths of seconds. And in many cases, these are the most interesting waves. This type of the waves are generated by winds, and sometimes generated by ships. Longer wave with the period of minutes to tenths of minutes are those generated from the typhoons and earthquakes. Longer wave with a period of about 12 or 24 hours, these are also called as tides, are caused by the relative motion between the Earth and the Moon and the Earth and the Sun. For instance, the gravitation between the Earth and the Moon causes the tides on Earth's surface at a period about 12 hours. The tides twice a day are called semi-diurnal tides, or 24 hours, the diurnal tides. It is well known that the winds are the main sources for the ocean waves. The simple mechanism can be understood as when the wind blows over the ocean surface, they generate the waves. However, the detailed mechanism is very complicated and not fully understood yet. Generally, it is believed there are three stages for establishment of the ocean waves. The first stage is the turbulent winds produce the random pressure fluctuation at the sea surface. Thus, the ripples, or a more technology term, the capillary waves, are generated by the pressure fluctuation. Here, it's the wind and the wave interaction and the energy transferred from wind to wave. The winds keep blowing on the sea surface to cause the wave to become larger. As the waves grow, the pressure differences get larger, which could cause the wave to increase. So this is the wind and the wave interaction. But the main energy flux is still from the wind to wave. And the dynamic interaction among the waves could generate longer waves and transfer the energy from the shorter wave to the longer wave, with the quadruplet wave and the wave interaction, or the triad wave and the wave interaction. And finally, the wave will be faster than the wind speed. To study the linear wave, a Cartesian coordinate is used, with the origin of the coordinate located on the surface of the calm water, and the z-axis pointed up vertically. Thus, the wave elevation can be described as z equals anti-zero, and x-axis points to the wave propagation direction. For a non-classical wave, it can be regarded as a 2D wave, which is independent of y. For the linear wave, the flow can be regarded as a rotational and incompressible flow. Thus, its velocity potential function satisfies the Laplace equation. And in this talk, we will see how the potential function is served from the Laplace equation and the corresponding boundary conditions. Here, the seabed condition is given as this. This is essentially non-penetration condition. That means the fluid cannot penetrate into the seabed. Under the assumptions of rotational and incompressible flow, the conventional Bernoulli's equation must be satisfied with the time-dependent constant C0. This constant must be chosen carefully for different applications. In this application, C0 must be chosen at the atmospheric pressure P0. So the Bernoulli equation can be written as this. The uniqueness and connectedness for C0 equaling to P0 can be justified when we reduce the wave amplitude to zero to a calm water. In that case, the corresponding velocity potential function phi would equal to zero or a constant. Thus, P equals P0 at Z equaling to zero at the surface in calm water. If we choose any other constant for C0 in this case, it would be not correct in such an application. The more complicated boundary conditions for wave theory is the free surface boundary conditions. In this slide, the kinematic boundary condition is discussed. The kinematic boundary condition for free surface can be derived from the substantial derivative of the parameter z minus anti zero, which must vanish on the free surface at this. It is because on the free surface, z minus anti zero is zero. Consider that z is an independent variable. So it is substantial derivative with regard to time is the same as the conventional derivative. Thus, differentiation with time t is actually the velocity component on z direction w. However, anti zero is a parameter or a function depending on other variables such as x, z, and time t. Thus, its substantial derivative is given by this. So substitute the velocity component based on the velocity potential function. We have equation as this. This is the exact kinematic boundary condition for the free surface. By dropping the higher order terms, we can have the linearized kinematic boundary conditions for the free surface. It should be noted that this linearized boundary condition is approximate at Z0. The dynamic boundary condition for the free surface can be derived from the Bernoulli's equation. Bernoulli's equation can be written as in this form. On the free surface, where Z equals to anti-zero, so the pressure P equals to the atmospheric pressure P0. So we can have the expression for the dynamic boundary condition on the free surface as this. Again, when we drop the high order term, we can get the linearized dynamic boundary condition for the free surface. This is the linearized dynamic boundary condition for free surface. It is approximate again at Z equaling to 0. Put the kinematic condition and the dynamic boundary condition together. We can have an equation for the free surface as this. From the appearance of the equation, it can be seen this is a typical wave equation. Because the equation for the free surface is a wave equation, thus, we can assume the 2D wave elevation has a form as this, where the A is the wave amplitude, K is the wave number, defined as 2 pi divided by the wavelength, and omega, the wave circular frequency. We can see the wave form for a fixed T, which is the wave in space. Thus, we can see the wave shape as if we take a snapshot of the wave. And the distance between the peaks here is the wavelength. We can also fix the position and observe the wave elevation at the fixed point. This is the wave. We use a wave prop to measure the wave at a fixed point. And the time between two peaks is the wave period, T. In mathematics, this wave elevation can be expressed as this by using the Euler formula as this. Here, Re means the real part of the complex. To simplify the mathematical manipulation, the wave elevation can be further expressed as this. It should be remembered, the actual value of the wave elevation is the real part of the expression. Since the fluid satisfies the 2D Laplace equation at the form as this, a general solution has a form as this. Substitute the general solution into the Laplace equation. We have the equation as this. Thus, the Laplace equation is transformed to an equation for the function capital Z, which depends on Z only. The equation for the capital Z, it has a general form as this, and we can simply check this general solution satisfied the equation as this. However, in this general solution, the capital C and the D must be decided using the relevant boundary conditions. Now, the wave velocity potential function can be expressed as this. In deep water, we can take H as an infinite, and the no penetration seabed condition would lead this equation. This equation will require D must be zero. Therefore, the velocity potential function is now as this, with the constant capital C to be decided. Now the wave elevation at the reference point Z equaling to zero is calculated as this, and compared to the wave elevation expression as this one, so we can obtain the constant C. As such, in the deep water, the wave velocity potential function is finally given as this. So it's real part of the wave velocity potential function is this. This is the velocity potential function for a wave of wave amplitude A and the wave frequency omega. Now we substitute the wave potential function into the free surface boundary condition. We can obtain the dispersion relation as this. This dispersion relation links the wave frequency and the wave number together. This is a very important relation for deep water waves, which can be used for deciding the wavelength, wave propagation speed, etc. In this slide, use the dispersion relation in deep water. We can obtain the relation between the wavelength and the wave period. Replacing omega with the wave period T and replacing the wave number with the wavelength, we have the equation as this. So this will lead to a wavelength calculation formula. So it can be seen in deep water, the wavelength is proportional to the wave period squared. So when we know the wavelength and the wave period, we can easily calculate the wave speed Vp. This is the phase speed calculated as this. So it can be seen the wave speed is proportional to the wave period. This means the longer waves travel faster. If the water wave have different colors for different wave frequencies as those in light, then the colored wave could travel at different speeds. Thus, the colors would be separated during the wave propagation.